Got lost on that last hymn. I didn't see the other page. So I think I skipped the whole second verse with you there, so my apologies. Not much of a good song leader, am I? All right, if you would open with me in your Bibles, please, to Galatians chapter number 1. And verse number 6, we'll begin there in just a moment. You'll remember that when we finished the Galatians series, which was a 37 or 38 messages, took us over a year to get through it with all the other sermons that we were doing. And I said that we would come back and we would do two addendums to the message. The first addendum we did was in February and March earlier this year, in which we clarified what is the true gospel. I believe we titled it, What is the Gospel We Preach? And we had a four-part series on defining the gospel that we preach. And then I said to you that I would come back later and do a second addendum and clarify some false gospels that are out there today that are prevalent in the church world, so that you would be able to identify them, so that you would be able to help those that are influenced or impacted by those teachings, so that you would be able to minister to them, right, or to be evangelistic in nature. Always looking out. The Bible says in the book of Proverbs that he that winneth souls is wise. We're always supposed to be winning souls, bringing people into the kingdom of God. So we said that we would clarify some of the false teachings or false gospels in particular. And we're going to take up four or five of them over the next 3 weeks. My goal is to be done with this before Pentecost Sunday, which is June 9th. So that June 9th we can give a message regarding Pentecost. And then the following Sunday is Father's Day, the 16th of June. So early happy Father's Day, men. And then the Sunday after that, we hope to start the book of Ephesians and begin teaching for a year, at least, in the book of Ephesians. So that kind of gives you an idea of what we're doing. So we're going to take up probably the most prevalent false gospel that is today in the world, and that's what we're going to teach on today. But I want us to go back to Galatians, kind of refresh our thinking for about 5 or 10 minutes about what Paul is saying here in the book of Galatians, and also to refresh our thinking for just a moment on what is the gospel. We spent 4 messages on it, but we're going to define it in about 30 seconds in just a moment, okay? So he says here in Galatians chapter 1, verse 6, I marvel that you are turning away so soon from him who called you in the grace of Christ to a different gospel. Now it's important to notice that these people were not going just from one form of theology or one form of doctrine or one gospel to another gospel. He says, I marvel that you're so soon turning from him. God, who called you in the grace of Christ to a different gospel. So when we leave the gospel, who do we leave? We leave God, right? If there's only one gospel, we've said this to you before, there's only one gospel, there's only one way to be saved. There's not 5 gospels and 5 ways to be saved. So if you depart from the gospel, you depart from God himself, who called you in the grace of Christ. And it's important that right away you see that he is emphasizing the grace of Christ. The reason why that's important is because anything that adds to the grace of Christ is no longer the gospel, right? If we add any sort of works or we add any sort of meritorious things that we have to do on our account to be justified in the sight of God, we have left the gospel. It is the gospel of the grace of Christ. He goes on in verse 7, which is not another. He's just simply saying there's not another gospel. There's only one gospel. But these people are trying to proclaim a different gospel to you. There are some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel of Christ. Now, the word pervert just means to twist. And what is so misleading about false gospels is because they'll somewhat sound true. Right? These people were not denying Jesus. They were just taking Jesus and belief in Jesus and adding something else to it. That's what the Judaizers were doing. Remember in Acts 15, verses 1 and 5, we talked about this before. You don't have to turn there. But it talked about how the Pharisees who believed, some of the sect of the Pharisees who believed, rose up saying it is necessary to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses. So what the Pharisees were saying, who believed, they believed in Jesus, but they said you can't just believe in Jesus and be saved. You have to believe in Jesus and you have to be circumcised and keep the law of Moses. They added something to the gospel. They said it's not just by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. It is faith in Jesus plus something else. It's Jesus and, or some people say Jesus but. Believe in Jesus, but you also have to. Believe in Jesus and keep the commandments. Believe in Jesus and do these things, then you can merit salvation. And that was the false gospel that Paul was facing in his day and age, was this idea that, now you got to think about it. Paul is combating 1,500 years of tradition. Right? I mean, that's how long they'd had the law of Moses. And their thinking at the time was that salvation was through the law of Moses. You couldn't be saved apart from the law of Moses. Now here comes this preacher after 1,500 years of living under that system saying, no, the law was simply pointing to Christ. And it's through Christ that we're justified by faith and faith alone. And it has nothing to do with the works of the law. Now can you imagine? I mean, you know, you take 50 years of tradition in a person's life. And you try to combat those 50 years of tradition, you'll have a hard time. You take 1,500 years of tradition and try to fight with that, that's hard to do. And that's what Paul is facing here. And so he's saying that these people are troubling you, perverting the gospel of Christ. They're taking the gospel and adding to it. And I told you before, right? You always look out for ands and buts, right? When people say believe in Jesus and, believe in Jesus but, right, that's your red flag right there. Then you know right away, and false gospel's coming out right now. Here it comes. And I promise you, you get most pastors to talk long enough, they'll say Jesus but, or Jesus and. All right, I've done this before. I mean, I used to hold nothing but pastor seminars overseas. And you get pastors talking for just a few moments, and then they're doing fine, they're doing fine. Just like the Pharisees, yeah, we believe in Jesus, we believe he died for us, yada, yada, yada. And then here it comes. And. But. And then here it comes, the second thing that they say that you have to do to be saved. So that's what they were doing. That's what Paul was facing. And he says, but even if we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you than what we have preached to you, let him be accursed. Now, does anybody remember what the gospel is that Paul preached? What's one scripture I told you, highlight it, circle it, put a star next to it, you know, have arrows, neon arrows pointing to it, if you can. Right, remember Acts 13, verse 38 and 39? Paul is preaching in Galatia. Here, he is writing to the Galatians. Acts 13, verse 38 and 39, he's preaching to the Galatians. You know what he says? Let it be known to you, brethren, that through this man is preached to you the forgiveness of sins. And by him, everyone who believes is justified from all things, from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses. That was the gospel, right? So he preached what? The forgiveness of sins through Jesus. That means the remission of sins, the removal of sins. And he preached justification by faith alone without the deeds or the works of the law. That's what he preached. So we defined it for you this way. I hope it's simpler to remember. We did it from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, right? The good news, the gospel is this, in a nutshell. God has reconciled you to himself through Jesus Christ, by not counting or not imputing your sins to you, but by counting or imputing your sins to Christ. And by you believing in Christ, his righteousness is imputed or counted to you. And God, from that moment forward, from the moment that you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, God views you as perfectly righteous in his sight. So right now, if you're a believer in Christ, sitting where you are right now, when God looks at you, though you may still sin, when God looks at you, he sees the righteousness of Christ. He looks at you as being clothed in his righteousness, that you, his righteousness, his perfect obedience is accredited to you. So in your bank account, it's full of righteousness before God. Now, you may not see yourself that way. I may not see myself that way, but that's how God sees you right now. That's good news. I said, that's good news. That's the gospel Paul preached. The Judaizers mixed it all up because they said, well, no, that's not right. You have to also be circumcised and keep the law of Moses in order to be saved. So they added something to it. That's what Paul is pronouncing a curse upon. And the word accursed means doomed for damnation, devoted to destruction, may he be condemned to hell. That's what some translations actually read it as. So now we understand the gospel Paul preached, the false gospel the Judaizers preached, and what was at stake, right? One is preaching salvation is by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. The Judaizers are preaching, no, that's not the case. You're justified by works also. Everybody got it? Easy stuff, right? We got it. If you know that much, you know the gospel, and you know enough to be able to identify false gospels. Because again, false gospels will always say what? And, or, but. So watch out for the ands and the buts, right? Watch out for those two things, right? Believe in Jesus, but you also have to be baptized. Believe in Jesus, but you also have to join our church. Believe in Jesus, but you also have to keep the law. What is that? False gospel. All right. Now, what we're going to take up today, and I realize that these types of messages are not necessarily popular. I think they should be popular, but they're not necessarily popular. And the reason why is because the drift of our society or our culture in the United States in particular, and really around the world, is a drift into religious pluralism. And religious pluralism is simply this. If you're a religious pluralist, you would say that although people have opposing views, opposing truth claims, that both views are equally correct and right. Right? That's religious pluralism. It's to say that everybody's view, nobody's wrong. Everybody's right. There's no absolute right, there's no absolute wrong, there's no absolute truth, there's no absolute lies, there's no black and white, everything is gray. There's no morality and immorality, it's just amorality. There's nothing. It's whatever you want is fine. And that's the drift of our culture, is into that type of thinking and that mindset. We don't want to offend anybody, because if we make it an exclusive claim, right? Jesus made exclusive claims all the time about himself, about God, about who he was, about salvation, about creation. He made exclusive claims all the time. But exclusive claims today are not popular because it then by nature excludes other people that don't agree or don't believe with that truth claim. So when we say that Jesus is the only way of salvation, we didn't say that. Jesus said that. Right? But when you say that Jesus is the only way of salvation, what does that do by nature? It excludes all those who don't believe that Jesus is the only way of salvation. And that's what people find offensive. And so they stumble over that because, well, I don't think that. I don't believe that. I don't agree with that. And now you have to accept my equal opposite truth claim. That's religious pluralism, okay? Religious pluralism is inclusivism. We're all included, right? It borders on, and sometimes just flat out is, universalism. Everybody will eventually be saved. That's universalism. Right? And that's what's popular today. Now, I believe this because Jesus believed it, and that is this: you can make truth claims that are exclusive but still walk in love. Right? How does Jesus taught us that we're supposed to love our enemies? We're supposed to, what's another one he said? Do good to those who hate us. It's not an easy thing to do. Do good to those who hate us. Pray for those who spitefully use us and persecute us. Right? So even though we make truth claims, If people persecute us over that, people despise us over that, people hate us because of that, people curse us over that, we still bless them, we still do good back to them, we still pray for them, right? So we're not people that make truth claims and then we're hateful and coarse toward people. We make truth claims, but we're still loving and gentle toward people. Does that make sense to you? Right? You can persecute me, but I'm not going to persecute you back. You can talk about me, but I'm not going to respond in kind. I'm not going to curse you because you cursed me, right? So that we can make truth claims without being unloving. The Bible tells us, Ephesians 4:15, speak the truth how? In love. Right? So we can speak truth in love, and so we're not being, what's the word I'm looking for? For example, I think you'll like this. We believe in religious freedom. We don't believe as Christians that we're going to force our beliefs down your throat and we're going to make a Christian society by making everybody become a Christian. Right? We don't coerce people to become Christians. We preach the gospel and the rest is between them and God. Right? We're not going to take somebody's arm and hold it behind their back and force their head down and say, you better believe this or else. You know, because throughout church history, people tried to do that. Literally, they would try to Christianize a nation. We conquer your country and we baptize everybody and say, you're all Christians now. Well, you can't be a Christian apart from faith. So just because you force someone to get baptized or they were going to die doesn't mean they're a Christian all of a sudden. Right? We believe in religious freedom. And to allow people the right to worship. But we also reserve the right to say, we're not religious pluralists. We don't agree with you. We think you're wrong, but we allow you to have your right, or we agree with your right to be able to worship in peace, right? I mean, that's very Christian and very American to the core. So in this message, we're not looking to slander anyone or slander a group of people or a denomination. We're just simply making truth claims. Based on Scripture, based on the Word of God, and equating or taking what the Word of God says versus what the Roman Catholic theologians would pronounce or profess. Okay? That's all we're doing. Now, the tricky thing, as we get into this, the tricky thing about Roman Catholicism is this. Okay? They believe in the Trinity, don't they? They have a Bible. They believe that Jesus died, that Jesus rose again. They believe that Jesus is God. They believe in the virgin birth. They believe in creation. They believe in essential things, essential doctrines that we also believe. And so it's difficult because, okay, you believe in Jesus, you believe he died, you believe he rose again, you believe in this. And so it's difficult to take that and say, well, wait, where's the distinction? Where's the difference? And the difference, again, is, as we're going to find out today in the study, is because they have Jesus and something else. Jesus and is throughout their catechism, throughout their Roman Catholic teaching. It's always Jesus and something else. So where they are in agreement with us, we're thankful that they agree with the Word of God. But in areas where they disagree with the Word of God, that's where we defer. Okay? Now you may think it's severe. Let me say this first. You may think it's severe. You'll notice that Paul pronounces a double curse, right? Verse 8 and 9. A curse upon anyone who preaches any other gospel than the one that he preached and the one that they received in Galatia. Now, that may seem severe, does it not? I mean, you're just saying, may he be condemned to hell if you preach a different gospel than the one I preach. And you might think, well, that's pretty intolerant of Christianity to think in such ways. Well, I'll have you know this, that in the Council of Trent, which was kind of during the Counter-Reformation time of the Roman Catholic Church, they pronounced 125 anathemas, the same word here. Basically, you had a bunch of mad Roman Catholics because the Protestant Reformation was going on, and they pronounced 125 different anathemas If you don't believe, for example, that there's seven sacraments, anathema, if you don't believe that the Eucharist, when blessed and consecrated, becomes the literal body and blood of Christ, you're anathema. And they pronounced a curse upon everyone that didn't agree with them on their major points of doctrine. 125 anathemas. And let me give you one example of that. Of course, I'm not going to read 125 to you. This is not on your paper. I couldn't fit everything on the paper. But listen to this, and then contrast it, or compare it, if you will, to what the Scriptures teach. I mean, this is the absolute opposite of what Paul was teaching in Galatians. This comes from the Council of Trent, canon number 9. If anyone shall say that the ungodly man is justified by faith, all right, that's Romans chapter 4 teaches this. If anyone shall say that the ungodly man is justified by faith only, so as to understand that nothing else is required that may cooperate to obtain the grace of justification, let him be accursed. So if you believe today that faith alone is all that's required to be justified in the sight of God, according to the Roman Catholic Church, you're accursed right now. They say the exact opposite of what the book of Romans and the book of Galatians says. And we could go on from there. That's just one sampling of the 125 anathemas. Basically, everything that the Protestant Reformation was proclaiming, they pronounced an anathema, a curse against those who were preaching that. So right now, by simple fact that we don't think that the Pope is the head of the Church, and by simple fact that we're not a part of the Roman Catholic Church, we're already anathematized. We're already, in their view, we're not saved, because salvation is only within the Church, the Roman Catholic Church. So do you think it's harsh when you read Galatians chapter 1, verses 6 to 9? Let me tell you, the only time the Bible, allows us to say you're accursed or you're anathema is when you do not believe in Jesus Christ, when you do not believe the gospel of Christ. Remember, even Jesus himself said, John chapter 3, verse 18, he said, he who believes in me is not condemned. But he who does not believe is what? Condemned already. You're already condemned if you don't believe in him. That's the only time in Scripture that we have this, and not that we even need to say it outwardly. That's the only time in the Scripture where a person is condemned, or a person is anathematized, or a person is accursed, is when they don't believe in Christ as the perfect substitute for their sins. That's it. Right. Not all the little fine details of our theology are fine details of our doctrine. Let me give you an example, okay? I think this is a good example. So, the body of Christ is very much divided into, you have Calvinists, you have Arminians, right? So you take John 3:16, and it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life." A Calvinist reads that and they say the world is a reference to Jews and Gentiles and those who are elect out of all the different nations of the world. It's not a reference to every single individual. It's a limited atonement. It's limited to those for whom God elected before the foundations of the world. The Arminian will say, no, the world is the whole world, that Jesus died for everyone. He died for all the sins of all the world, of all people, of all time. The Calvinist says, no, it's just for the elect of out of every tribe, tongue, people, and nation. Well, here's the thing. We can disagree on that, but the important thing is this. They don't disagree on the fact that Jesus died for our sins, and that he arose for our justification, and that we're both justified by faith alone. So nobody's going to go to hell over that, because you agree, whether you say that it's a limited atonement only for the elect, or it's an unlimited atonement, it's available for all. You can disagree about stuff like that all day long, and nobody's going to be accursed over that. Nobody's going to be anathematized over that. But when you deny the gospel and you deny that salvation is through faith alone in Christ, that's the only time that the Bible emphatically says, yeah, you're condemned. Okay? Roman Catholicism will condemn you on all counts. Oh, you don't believe this about the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God? You're accursed! All right, you following me? So, let me say this, and then we're going to try to run through this list and try to give some explanation and commentary on the list of things that I came up with for you guys. The way that the Protestant Reformation got started is this, okay? Two main things were the issue. Number one is the subject of justification, and number two was the authority, the issue of authority. When we say the issue of authority, we mean this, is the authority in the Pope, is the authority in the magisterium, the church councils, the teaching body of the Roman Catholic Church, is the authority there, or is the authority in Scripture alone? Well, Roman Catholicism said the authority was in the Pope, the authority was in the magisterium, the teaching body of the Roman Catholic Church, and only they have the ability to interpret Scripture, and only they have the ability to interpret the tradition of the Roman Catholic Church. So that's why you don't have many Roman Catholics that read their Bibles. Because there's no use to reading their Bible, because the only ones that can interpret it and the only ones that can understand it are those that are in the magisterium. Okay? And that's dangerous, because if the common people can't read their Bibles, they don't know if they're being led astray or not. Alright, so this was the issue. And Martin Luther comes along, and Martin Luther says, hey, there's no authority in the Pope. There's no authority in the church councils. There's no authority in the magisterium. The authority is in Scripture and Scripture alone. It's sola scriptura. It's the Scripture alone. The Bible alone is God's Word. And that's where the authority is. So that whether it's the Pope who, let's say the Pope was here this morning. All right? And I mean, he's the pastor of the entire church. That's what they believe. Can you imagine that? You got over a billion people in your church. If he was here today and he spoke, but when he spoke, he could not open the Scriptures and prove from the Scriptures he has no authority. But you have a common person like you and I stand up, and we can open the Scriptures, we can teach from the Scriptures, we can show you in the Scriptures. Now that person has authority, because why? Scripture has authority. Okay? That's the formal principle of the Reformation. And then you have the material principle of the Reformation, which was the subject of justification. And here's the question. How is a person justified in the sight of God? Is it by faith alone? Or is it by faith, baptism, and the sacraments? Is it by faith, baptism, and the commandments? Faith alone, right? And so sola fide comes out. Faith alone. And that these were the two big things that started the Reformation. Authority is in Scripture alone, and salvation is by faith alone. It has nothing to do with sacraments and baptism and penance and all of these other things that you go through. And these were the two things that they split with. Okay? Now, let's try to get through this list as quickly as we can. Okay? When we don't finish, maybe we can carry over into next week. Now, I noticed in the top, I did not call it the nine primary differences. There are other differences. This is all I could fit on the front and back of one page, so I didn't go beyond this. So there's just nine, but there's a list of others. But these are the most important ones. Number one is they believe that they are re-offering Christ during every Mass. All right? Here's from their own, this is the Catechism of the Catholic Church that I'm quoting from. For it is in the liturgy, the liturgy is referring to the Mass, especially in the divine sacrifice of the Eucharist, that the work of our redemption is accomplished. So do you believe that the work of our redemption is accomplished when we take communion? Or do you believe the work of redemption was accomplished when Jesus was on the cross and he says it is finished? Amen? This is a big difference between believing that it was accomplished 2,000 years ago versus believing it's accomplished right now, at the present time, through the Eucharist. The Eucharist is thus a sacrifice because it represents or makes present the sacrifice of the cross. So they believe, follow me here. So when the priest stands up, before the people, and he takes the big host, bam. They believe that at that very moment, when he says hocus corpus meum, that bam, it becomes the literal body of the Lord Jesus Christ. Transubstantiation takes place. And now, it's no longer the bread he's holding, it's Jesus Christ. Okay? And when Jesus is broken, it is a re-sacrifice of Jesus Christ at the altar. Remember, the Roman Catholic Church, what do they have in the front of the church? An altar. And at that altar, what sacrifice do they make at every Mass? The re-sacrifice of Jesus Christ. So they're re-sacrificing Jesus at the altar every single Mass, and they believe that when he consecrates the host, which means that in Latin that would mean that this is my body, that he's literally reaching up into heaven and taking Jesus down. And now if you partake of that bread and of the cup after the consecration takes place, you're actually getting who inside of you? Jesus. So when they march in procession, you'll see a march in procession sometimes with the host held high, and everybody's worshiping and bowing down to the host. Was it the bread they're worshiping, or is it because they believe that that host is now who? Jesus. They believe that it's Jesus. That's why in the Roman Catholic Church, they have they call it a tabernacle. Have you ever noticed that the priest is always bowing, kneeling, genuflecting throughout the service, the ceremony? When people come in, they sprinkle holy water, make the sign of the cross, they genuflect. Why? They're going before the tabernacle, and inside that tabernacle, usually it's like a golden box. Ever hear the expression, God in the box? Well, the Roman Catholic Church has God in the box. They have a consecrated host in that box, and if it's been consecrated by the priest, who is it in the box? It's Jesus. So they believe Jesus is in the box, and so when you pass the box, you got to genuflect or kneel or bow and bless the box because Jesus is in the box. You can't make this stuff up. This is just amazing. I mean, it would take a lot more faith to believe this, all right, than to believe the Bible. All right, the sacrifice of Christ and the sacrifice of the Eucharist are one single sacrifice. Right? So for them, it's no different what happened to Jesus on the cross 2,000 years ago and what they're practicing today in every single Mass. It is a re-sacrificing of Christ. And notice at the very end, I'm not going to read the whole paragraph, this sacrifice is truly propitiatory. Now we know in this church what a propitiation is. It's a sacrifice to appease the wrath of God. So what they're saying is that Jesus 2,000 years ago did not appease God's wrath or satisfy God's wrath. It has to be appeased today, and the only way to do that is to partake daily of the Eucharist, to partake of this consecrated host. And then by then, this is a propitiatory sacrifice. It's a never-ending sacrifice. Okay. And this is all we're going to get into today, so I want to close by reading three scriptures to you from the book of Hebrews. You can look at them if you want to. You don't have to look at them if you don't want to. But we'll come back next week. I spent a little bit more time in my introduction than I planned to. Hebrews chapter 7. Get there first. Okay. Verses 26 through 27. For such a high priest was fitting for us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, has become higher than the heavens. He does not need daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifices first for his own sins and then for the people's. For this he did once for all when he offered himself up. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 26 through 28. He then would have had to suffer often since the foundation of the world, but now once, at the end of the ages, he has appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed for men to die once, but after this the judgment, so Christ has offered once to bear the sins of many. To those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time, apart from sin, for salvation. And lastly, Hebrews 10, verse 12, But this man, after he'd offered up one sacrifice for sins forever. How many sacrifices? One sacrifice for sins for how long? Forever. Sat down at the right hand of God, waiting till his enemies be made his footstool. So we see again and again in Scripture that it is said that Jesus made one sacrifice for sins forever. We do not re-sacrifice the Son of God over and over and over again. Because to do that, and this is going to be the theme throughout this teaching, is to deny the sufficiency of Christ. Christ's sacrifice, if you believe this, then 2,000 years ago, was an insufficient sacrifice. It was deficient. And we have to make up for his deficiency by re-sacrificing him every single Mass. Think about how many billions of times Jesus has been sacrificed, if you believe that. Billions of times. So we can't say that you start to see here the distinctions are serious distinctions. It's not distinctions about minor things. Limited atonement, unlimited atonement, for example. We can disagree about that, but still believe that a person is justified by faith only, and therefore both be saved. It's not a minor. This is a big thing, because they're saying that in order to be saved, we have to continually sacrifice Jesus over and over again. That's why the Reformers referred to it, what did they call it? An accursed idolatry. We just read it in the Heidelberg Catechism. Now in modern days, here you go, modern day, you know what people are doing? That no longer applies anymore. We don't believe that anymore. We'll leave it there, but we'll bracket it off and say that, you know, we just don't agree with this anymore. The Roman Catholic Church has changed and we don't believe this. That's today. But the Reformers put that in there because it was an idolatrous practice. The fact that you could crucify again, over and over, the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray, and then, like I said, in the coming weeks, we're going to take this a little bit further, explain the differences in such a way that you'll be able to understand, and see that these are core issues. These are not minor, trivial issues, but core issues. And then we'll take up other things. The social gospel, we'll talk about that. We're going to talk about humanism. Humanism has infiltrated the church. We're going to make the world a better place. Everybody's A-okay. We're all a bunch of good people. You know, that humanism is in the church. And some others as well. But let's pray. Father, thank you that we can minister such things with grace in our hearts, because we know that your word is true, and we have a desire to reach those who have not yet been enlightened by the truth of your word. We thank you, Father, that your word is true, and that we are those who believe that the Bible alone is the word of God. We do not subscribe to the traditions of men or the beliefs that men are infallible, the leaders of the church are infallible. We know that is not the case. Only your word is infallible. Help us to preach, to teach, to speak loudly the words of God, and may register upon our hearts that others may be saved also. In Jesus' name, amen.